everyone doing tonight? Thank you so much for tuning in to the news with Obi. I am joined by none other than Mr. Saikou Camara. He is he's a good friend. I met him when he was at the UN talking about, I think it was African Book Week or something like that. Yes. So I was interviewing African authors at that event. That's how we actually met. And I'm glad to get to know this man. I hope you will get to know him as well once you hear him speak this evening. And I'm going to read, by the way, how are you doing?
I'm doing great, Obi. And you know, I love what you do and I love how you do when you do what you do. So thank you for having me.
Thank you so much for being on the show. I've been meaning to get you on the show for a while, but this time around seems more timely. And mm-hmm. I hope our viewers get to see and understand why. So I want to read a little bit of your bio. You guys, his bio is long. Like, he has done so much. So I'm just going to read a little bit. And we have to also understand that for far too long, non-immigrants have been telling the immigrant story, you know, and people like Saikou Camara has been changing that narrative. And like Africans, you know that, and you mentioned it in your bio as well, what we do is instrumental into storytelling. We are storytellers at heart. And this is what you've been demonstrating. This is what you've been doing with your speeches, your talks, and your book. Let me see here. He perceives storytelling as an art form that links us to our past and gives us foresight into the future. He's been invited to speak at the White House, the United Nations, the Montfort University in the UK, Bowie State University, and the list goes on. He has a book, two books. The first one is Testimony of an African Immigrant, A Promise to My Father. And the second one is Africa Through a Mirror, We Have a Continent to Build. Once again, welcome to the show. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me. The honor is all mine, Obi.
Thank you. So let's dive right into it. You have a brand. Your brand, I love that brand, by the way. And I see you're rocking the t-shirt tonight. It's called Hustle Like an Immigrant. That's a dope brand. It's a dope phrase. Yeah. Talk to us about how you came up with that and, you know, tell us your story.
I just realized that the status of immigration or immigrants is almost criminalized now, right? Whether it is young Africans trying to young West Africans trying to go to South Africa, where we experience what we all know about the xenophobia over there, where our young brothers and sisters have been murdered and killed, and whether it is our young brothers and sisters who are camping in seashores of Libya, or we're trying to get through Morocco to get to Spain and all that. We are aware of that. We've seen young Africans being captured in the 20th century or the 21st century, however you look at it, right, and sold into slavery in our own continent. We have seen all that, all because of what? That's we have witnessed all of that. We have seen all right groups and right-wing groups, whether it is Asia, whether it is in Europe, whether it is in Americas. We have seen all of those groups rose up and almost trying to criminalize immigration and trying to make immigration or immigrant make look like it's a bad stereotype, right? And people are trying everything they could. You will see Africans trying so hard to change our accent, to talk like other people, so that we can more accept it, so that we can more camouflage and just be more inclusive and all of that. So I figured all of that is because of, in my opinion, is people are scared and afraid of what immigration stands for, right? So I'm trying to dissect that and break it down for people, that the idea, the mindset of hustle like an immigrant have nothing to do with your immigration status to begin with, right? It has everything to do with your mindset. Why is it that it doesn't matter whether you're African, Asian, European, it doesn't matter where you are. When you move, when you travel, heck, let's talk about America. When immigrants came to America, they changed this land. I'm not in support of what they did to the natives. I'm not advocating for making it look okay what they did to the native. I'm just saying, when people travel, something happens. Something is triggered, right? Yeah. So I'm trying to let people understand that what does it mean when we say hustle like an immigrant? It starts here. It's a mindset. It's a Canadian researcher who said that immigrants are three times more likely to become multimillionaires than anywhere they go.
Right.
That's behind it. And based on my own research, based on looking at it, I came up with five distinct steps that I figured this is what the hustle-like and immigrant mindset is all about. This is when people become more successful when they move from point A to point B. And I think those things can be learned and they can be taught. So we can talk about those. I can share some of those
qualities
and characteristics as well.
Okay, we'll share as we go along. And I want to welcome everybody for tuning in. Feel free to leave a comment. If you have a question for Mr. Saikou Camara tonight, you can type it in and we'll see it and we'll read it out. If you want to give him a shout out, if you want to ask him where you can get his book, this will be the time, because we're getting some free knowledge dropped on us tonight. Believe it, I'm telling you, we are. So in your first book, Testimony of an African Immigrant, A Promise to My Father, you talk quite a bit about your upbringing in the Gambia and how it's been instrumental to the man that you are today. Mm-hmm. When did you realize you wanted to write that first book?
I will also draw your attention back to our history as people, where we come from first, right? And I would like to take you and your audience back to when the TV were black and white, back to the Congos, right? And I would take you back to a great man, a grandson of our continent, Patrice Lumumba, his last letter to his wife, Josephine, at least one of his wives, because he has two wives, both men, Josephine's, and they both claim that the letter belongs to them. So I'm not going to take it away from anyone. They both have it. So whichever Josephine feels like the letter is for them, I'm talking about you right now.
Later,
he mentioned certain very important things and key facts that every young Pan-African or every Pan-African should at least have it at the back of your mind at every given moment. And I'm just going to try to paraphrase some of the things that he said in the letter written in French. By the way, I don't speak French. I just read the translated version in English. So I'm trying to paraphrase some of the contents of the letter. And in the letter, he said, "Dear Josephine, I wrote to you without knowing whether you will receive this letter, and if you receive it, if I'll be dead or alive. But I want you to know that no amount of cruelty, torture, or punishment is going to make me beg for my life. I'd rather die with my head held high and rather than to live in humility and denounce the principles that I considered sacred to me. And please, when I die, don't cry. And tell my children that I expect them and every son of the Congo to fulfill the destiny of our country. I have no doubt that one day the history of Africa will be written by Africans. And it will not be the history taught at the United Nations, Washington, Paris, or Brussels. It will be the history of pride and dignity. This is the last word of a great son of Africa."
Yes.
That is a call to our generation. When he said the history of Africa will be written by Africans, both on the north and the south of the Sahara, we are that generation. So writing, I don't actually always consider myself a writer, because writing has such an old tradition and is guided by all these old guards and all these principles that you can do. And I'm too radical with my writing style. I don't follow all the Wesleyan dictionary punctuation recommendations. Yeah. I don't follow all the right subject verb agreement. No, I write the way I speak. Sometimes when you read my writing, you can almost sense my thick accent coming through the pages. But I love that. So I don't consider myself a writer. I consider myself a storyteller. Right. And I just happen to tell my story through black and white. And this is one of the main reasons why I write, just answering to a call of a great Africans. But at the same time, also listening to great writers before me, when you talk about the Chinua Achebe of our continent, and he said that African writers have three major responsibilities. Yeah. One, we must serve as historians to rescue our past. We must serve as critics to analyze our present. And we must have as mentors to guide our future moving forward. And these are the things that motivate and inspire me to write.
Wow. Yeah. So it's been a lifelong dream of yours, you know, based on these people that you look up to, these authors that you look up to write your own book.
Right.
Yeah. And not only did you write one book, you went on to write a second book, Africa Through a Mirror, We Have a Continent to Build.
Right.
And in that book, you ask a lot of questions, you know, and I also point out that unless we examine and analyze and understand our problems as Africans, we won't be able to solve them.
Yes.
With that being said, and I know this is a broad question, what would you say our biggest problem in Africa is? Is it lack of good leadership? Is it resources? We know we have the resources because that's not it. Mm-hmm. So what would you say our biggest problem is?
The simplest and quickest answer to that is I'll have to defer to my Nigerian brother again, Chinua Achebe. That man is dope.
Yeah,
Africa's problem is quietly that of leadership problem, right? Yeah. But that is the simplistic answer. And but if you also listen to our Kenyan brother, he said that PLO Lumumba. Mm-hmm. He said that the African the windmill move in the direction of the wind.
Right.
We the demos, right? We the voters, we the electorates, we are the people that determine the people we put in office. So right. Our leaders are a reflection of us. We are the wind, and our leaders are only a windmill that move in the direction that we're blowing, right? So that is an indictment, in my opinion, to all Africans, considering the amount of horrible, terrible leadership that we have produced in our continent. And this is not because of we lack competent human beings that can lead. But the problem, again, like PLO Lumumba said, in Africa, people who have power have no ideas, and people who have ideas have no power. And people who have both, we kill them, right? Whether it's the Patrice Lumumbas of Congo, or whether it's the Kwame Nkrumahs, who America Capra described as did not die of cancer, but die of the cancer of betrayal, right? So these are all great men that we killed in our own continent, that we betrayed. So African leaders who happen to make it to political office and stay longer are terribly failing our continent. But my main argument in the book doesn't only talk about African leadership. I also want to look at what are all the things that are self-inflicted. Like you said, I asked too many questions in the book, but this is the truth. Whether we like it or not, this is the undeniable truth.
Of course.
One thing I understand is that Africa is the most humiliated and dehumanized continent in the face of the universe. This is a fact. This is something that's undisputable. At the same time, I also realized that Africa went through some of the worst things in humanity, whether it is drought, whether it is famine, whether it is diseases, whether it is wars. I understand all of this, colonialism, slavery, I understand all of that. And I am not underplaying or undermining any of those things. I am saying with all these things, in spite of all these things, what are some of the things that we Africans are responsible for today that is hindering us, right? When you look at basic things, like in the countries like Congo, where it is been described by human rights or female human rights activists as the rape capital of the universe. These are African women being raped by African men. They have nothing to do with colonialism or slavery. When you look at today what happened in the countries like Liberia, where young babies have been killed, their hearts snatched out of their chests and been consumed by their killers because they believe it gives them supernatural powers, right? When you talk about Cry Freetown, the war in Sierra Leone, where young people, their limbs have been chopped off, right? Where the rebel leaders are claiming that Operation No Living Soul, they kill everything they come across. These are self-inflicted. When you look at Guinea-Bissau, a country that never had a president complete a presidential term limit, coup d'etats upon coup d'etats.
But someone can also argue or say that, yes, these are crimes committed by Africans on their own people.
Right.
But at the same time, someone can also say that the white man somewhere was instigating it.
So this is the truth. If you remember a few years ago, Tony Blair came out and said that Africa is a bolt from the consent of the universe. My argument to that is we can blame almost every problem in the African continent on white people at some point. The colonizer literally destroyed Africa for many centuries to come. But that's why I said I made those arguments in spite of.
Yeah,
I understand that these things are already there, but white people are not about to write their wrongs against our people. Come on.
They're not.
What we can control is what you and I are doing wrong, what our founding leaders, and I talked about them as much as celebrated the Kwame Nkrumah. I also talked about some of their shortcomings, right? Whether it is the Nyerere of Tanzania, I talked about their shortcomings, right? You, all of these people, I talked about the things they did right, the Kawundas. I talked about the things they did right and things I feel like we, the young Africans, can learn from to improve from the work that they do. So, yes, I agree with you. Anyone can make an argument that some of these problems are being, in fact, instigated by outsiders. But at the same time, we have to take responsibility for our own actions.
Yeah, we have to do something. But the thing is, even if somebody decides to, let's say you live in the U.S. and you decide to go home to run for office, it's not usually easy at all. Yeah. It's almost impossible. And that's also because you have those old politicians that don't want to leave, that that stay in office for so long. So it's good to talk about these things, but I also want us to talk about solutions as we go on. I don't know what the solution to that will be. Do you have any suggestions?
In my opinion, I will again borrow from great Africans, right? This is something that if you look at throughout our history, in my opinion, in fact, I feel like the African is the most politically woken human being in the world, because our life are so much conditioned by politics. Everywhere we go, all we talk about is politics.
Yeah.
Right? Whether we like it or not, it's two things we talk about. If we are talking about the British Premier League, we are fighting about politics. Well, these are the things we talk about.
Even if it's politics, not our country politics, we'll talk about different countries' politics.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. So one of the first thing out there, like Pierre Lumumba said, we need a single agenda conference to begin with. We need to bring Africans from all over the continent into one conference. I'm not talking about the meetings that the AU are doing that are meaningless and useless for the most part. Just bring our brightminds, our think tanks. Let's bring the think tanks together in one conference. So talk about one thing and one thing only. What are Africa's problems? Let's list them, let's figure it out, let's accept them. Let's come to terms with, we consider these legit things to be a major thing that we believe, if we're correct, can at least move our continent further. Take a break, go home, come back the next day. Let's talk about what are the solutions to these problems that we are facing. And then when we have those solutions agreed upon, then we can go back into our respective countries and start from the grassroots, from our small chiefs, our small community leaders, our small governors, our small city councils, our church leaders, our mosque leaders, our traditional medics, everything you can think. Let's start from the bottom grassroots and build up where change is not coming from our political powers. Change is coming from our everyday people who can help instill and believe in these things. Because one of the biggest problems we have, in my opinion, is the people who are making these decisions, people who are drafting constitutions, people who are actually coming up with political manifestos, they themselves don't live the life a day in their life.
Right.
When you look at the agricultural department, you find very fancy people with fancy degrees who cannot differentiate between a spade and a shovel for you. But they want to make policies for farmers who go to the ground every day and trying to make something out of us and make a living for their families. It's not going to work, right? When we're talking about people who come up with our educational curriculum, matter of fact, they don't even come up with educational curriculum. They just looked at the things that the British did.
And repeat.
Repeat. And they think that's going to work, right? Yeah. But if you look at our continent, we are so far behind. If you want to build engineers, doctors, lawyers, and all these fancy white-collar workers, we will be out forever. One of the things that I believe we need to do is we need to focus on like things like vocational schools, right?
Right.
Let's teach people how to fish. You don't need to learn how to properly punctuate a sentence to know how to fish.
Yeah.
Let's teach people how to build a home, how to build a house, right? These are things I feel like even people do not finish high school, people do not finish secondary school. If government institutions invest in more vocational schools and train our young people on how to do this technical work, they can live for themselves.
We need to start moving away from, if you don't have a degree, it doesn't, you know, like we need to start moving away from that.
We need to start moving away from that. We are so far behind. We are 400 years behind the rest of the world. We cannot play catch up by running at the same speed the rest of the world is running. We need to be more creative and try things that other people are not doing.
Yeah, most definitely. And once again, thank you for those that are watching. Thank you so much. I see Ifuashi saying hello. Thank you for being here. Thank you for joining us. If you have any questions for Saikou Camara, please type them in, and he will address those questions. If you want to ask him how you can get a copy of his books, feel free to ask as well. So let's switch gears a little bit, right? So let's talk about the recent events happening here in the U.S. The Black Lives Matter movement. We've seen what's been happening for the past few months. Both cities, I live in New York City. There's been a protest every single day for the past month and a half. And you wrote an article. You wrote an article about that titled, If You Don't Know, Now You Know. And in the article, you talk about your first encounter with the police. Now, as an African immigrant, why is the Black Lives Matter movement important to you?
First of all, I'm black. Right? I'm blackity black. That's the first thing, right? And, I don't care what it is. I don't care where it is. Anything that affects black people anywhere, I take it personal. And I see myself in it. And I just wanted to defy you back a little bit again to something completely different before I answer that question, right? Because I feel like the Black Lives Matter movement is bigger than just America. The Black Lives Matter movement is bigger than just police brutality in America. The Black Lives Matter movement is about the, a conscious effort by black people everywhere in the world saying that enough is enough, and we demand that our life matters. Because as black people, our very claim to humanity is sometimes put into question by other people who are different from us. And I wonder why. But if you look at, let's say, even in Mexico, there's a forgotten African tribe in Mexico. The black African Latinos in Mexico, they have been there since 1519. They were there a whole century before slaves came to America. They were brought there by the Spanish. But they were not recognized as Afro-Latinos until 1992.
Wow.
Think about that. From 1519, you are living in a place, and they did not recognize you until 1992. When you go to India right now, there's a lot of lost African tribe right now that I believe that came from the Bantu tribe of East Africa. And if you go to is the Kamataka, I believe it's called the Kamataka state in India. It's about over 20,000 black as you and I, big black Africans living there since the 7th centuries, who were brought there as slaves by the Arabs. Those people up till today, when you go to their schools, their schools are depleted. They're living in the most depleted part of India, right? They have no hospitals. They have no clean waters. They have no electricity. They literally are the most backward community in the entire Indian society.
Yeah.
These are blacks living in India. When you talk about China, we saw how they were treating our brothers. You can't even get into McDonald's during the coronavirus. And the virus is believed to come from where? China.
Yeah.
And they were discriminating against Africans.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable. So that's the first thing I want to make clear, that the idea of Black Lives Matter is not really about America. America is about Africa, is about Asia. Matter of fact, one of my friends and my good brother was protesting in Africa, in Gambia, for Black Lives Matter. And he went out and made a statement about our government, our own African government, the Gambia government, killing Gambians. And the death were unresolved, and the police are still investigating 3 years later.
Yeah.
They arrested him and put him and charged him for broadcasting false information against the government. So the Black Lives Matter is everywhere. But bringing back to your question.
Yeah.
As an African in America, I realize that every privilege that I enjoy here today is not because of my smartness, not because of my intelligence, not because of my good looks, and not because of my culture, heritage, religion, or anything. It's solely because of the African-American have fought, marched, died, and still dying for me to enjoy those freedoms that I'm enjoying today. Whether it is the affirmative action signed by the President Lyndon Johnson's government, that is why too many people like myself are now employed in corporate America, enjoying nice salaries, not because of we are good. I'm not saying that we are not good at what we do. But left to some people in corporate America, you and I know very well that we may never see a day in corporate America.
They still don't. I mean,
exactly. So even with affirmative action, they still find loopholes around it to keep us out of it. So imagine if we don't have that option at all, right? So I understand that the reason why I was able to have a very nice paycheck every month working in corporate America is because the African American have fought and died for that freedom. Yeah. The reason why I live in a very nice neighborhood today, a very nice gated neighborhood for that matter, is because of the 1968 Fair Housing Bill that was signed a week after Martin Luther King was assassinated in Memphis, Tennessee. If that housing bill was not signed, people like me would have never been allowed to live in certain communities in America. And we know this. And even with that bill, they still find ways not to get us or accept us to live in certain areas, right? Yeah. The 1964 Civil Rights Bill brought an end to Jim Crow in America.
Yeah.
Because of that, you and I can fly in nice airplanes and sit in the same cabin with other people, right? We can travel and live in nice hotels. We can eat at nice fancy restaurants with posh cuisines and enjoy them, right? These are all things that we enjoy. We can go to schools with predominantly white institutions, even though I attended HBCUs, but other people can. They can go to predominantly white institutions where they can attend higher education. And all of those things came through the African American fighting for those rights. So as an African today, I feel it was my moral responsibility to make sure that even if I'm not affected by racism or police brutality, just because the sheer responsibility I have towards people like me, people who died before me, people who paved the way before me, I owe it to them to make sure that I also stand hand in hand with them when when their lives are at risk. Especially, moreover, when all of our lives are at risk. I have a daughter today.
Yeah,
he's a born American. I have a choice. I wasn't born here. I came here. If I don't like it here, I can pack up my little fancy degrees. I'm out of here.
Right.
She has no choice.
Right.
This is home for her. She didn't choose to be born here. So if nothing else, I owe it to her to make sure that I leave this place a better place than I found it.
And to come back to what you were saying, that Black Lives Matter is just not about America.
Right.
The whole world looks up to America, right? Any change, America sneezes, the whole world stops, right?
It's the whole America, yeah.
Right. So, I mean, the person we have in office right now is kind of like tarnishing that, but still holds that, you know, whatever happens in the U.S., a lot of people take note. So Black Lives Matter affects anybody else that lives in Australia, that lives any part of the world. So what we are doing right now, the protests, the marching and everything, is setting a precedent for years to come, right?
Yes, we are.
It is. And I want to acknowledge the people in the room. I have Jenny, my good friend Jenny says, thank you for sharing and inspiring immigrants. Jenny's from the Philippines. We have Ifua is from Ghana. She's acknowledging everything you were saying. And we have my good friend, Fidelia. She's from Uganda. She says, thank you for acknowledging that, Mr. Camara. Many of our people forget that. And I believe she is referring to why we should be part of Black Lives Matter and how we are benefiting from everything that African-Americans have fought for before, you know, we came here.
Yeah.
So what about first of all, why do you think the relationship between Africans and African Americans is so complicated? I mean, I had a show one time called African Americans and Chile Coexistence, and I've done that show twice, and a lot of people had a lot to say about that. Mm-hmm. And you had Africans that tuned into the show that were saying, "Oh well, African Americans, you mess up your own neighborhoods. You pee in your elevators. You pee in the stairway." And you also have Africans that don't understand that what's happening in America is systemic.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You know, you have this thing called white fragility. It is a thing. And, you know, when it's just like when we cry Black Lives Matter, somebody says All Lives Matter.
Right. Or
somebody said when there's a Black History Month, somebody's asking, why isn't there a White History Month? White history. Right. It's history everywhere, period. Period, that's it. So there's no such thing as a white, as a white person, your history, we're not. So talk to me about why you think the relationship between our own brothers and sisters, African-Americans, has been contentious most of the time.
this one is raw, right? This one has dips because, like I said, I am here fist in the air, like Black Lives Matter, all of that, right?
Yeah.
Saying and challenging my African counterparts to say, hey, let's come out and let's stand hand in hand in solidarity with African American brothers. Let's do this right.
Yeah.
At the same time, I am also an immigrant here that came here as a young man. And the first time I felt like I was ever discriminated against, it wasn't a white person. At least that was the first time I recognized it. It was from my college roommate. I attended HBCUs, by the way, shout out to Ross College, you know, Holly Springs, Mississippi, Jackson State University, Jackson, Mississippi. And by the way, shout out to my fraternity brothers, Omega Psi Phi, root to the bros. That's so just letting you know, like my roommate, this was Hurricane Katrina, right? We were in college, Hurricane Katrina, and 106 and Park came on, free and aid day.
Okay. You know
that, right? So I was watching CNN, the coverage and whatever, and he walked into the room and flipped the channel. And it was 106 and Park. I'm like, oh yeah, I don't mind watching Bow Wow, right? But right now, something a little bit more serious going on. Like, people dying in New Orleans, just few miles from here, right? We're in Mississippi. So I'm like, can we watch this?
Right.
And he just went up on me, cussed me out, called me name, and told me, you just stupid, man. You're just an African. This is America. Wake up. Like, he used all those kind of, you know, passive aggressive, you know, slurs against me or whatnot.
Yeah.
And I've looked at him like, my GPA is almost 4.0. Mm. You barely, like, his GPA was like 2.4. You're calling me stupid and ignorant. I'm so confused. Like, dude, I do your homeworks for you. I write your papers for you. What are you talking about, right? But then it took me a minute to realize that he's not talking about my intellect. He was talking about my culture, right?
Okay.
So, but one of the best things that also happened to me is when I came to America, I first landed in Harlem, New York.
Okay.
From New York, I was in Atlanta, right? Okay. Chocolate City, right? Black Hollywood.
You hit the black spots.
Black spots. Then I was in Mississippi, Holly Springs, HBCU, nothing but black people around me.
Exactly. Right?
So I quickly had to learn African-American culture.
Right.
I remember one time in the cafeteria that I was eating with friends, somebody made your mama joke. And they were like, your mama. And I was like, hold up now. Say what? Like, you don't talk about mama. You know this. You're African person, your mama.
Right.
You don't do that.
Right. Those are fighting words.
Right. So he said, like, your mama, and I was ready to throw down. So I have to understand that he doesn't mean no foul by it.
Yeah.
That is just how they talk. And I heard him say even worse things to his other African-American friends. I'm like, oh, this is okay? This is how y'all talk? I learned that. So I learned to fight with African-Americans without taking it personal to go like, okay, they hate me. I just look at it as if I live with my own African brothers, growing up, my own siblings, we fought in the house. I don't take it personal as they hate me as an African. I just look at it as this one African American, my roommate, who made those ignorant statements. All these other people, not so much. So I'm not going to take it personal. That's one thing first.
Right.
The second thing is they also learn certain things about me as well. They also learn that, okay, you don't talk about an African's, you know, they don't do that.
Right.
So you got to make sure you don't hit those sound bites or lines or whatever.
Yeah.
What is the biggest mistake that happened between the African and the African American is that we assume that a Sierra complexion supposed to automatically translate into a Sierra culture or brotherhood or commonality.
That's what we as African assume, but
It doesn't work that way. What we didn't realize is that we have been apart for 400 years. Mm. Our cultures evolved. Our struggles were different.
Yes.
I don't care how African you are. You don't know what it means to go through 400 years of slavery and Jim Crow. No. I don't care how much African American you are. You don't know what it means to go through slavery, colonialism, neocolonialism, and now effed up African government. Our struggles are unique and different. So we never took our time to learn each other's struggles.
Exactly.
And everything that African Americans learn from about Africa, for the most part, they learn it from a Eurocentric perspective. We are fueled by Afro-pessimists, right? So when they understood, when they talk about Africa, they talk about it from a position of less than.
Yes.
We Africans also learn about African-American from our white co-workers and our white people. Yeah. We assume that white people, the African Americans, are lazy and violent, gun-carrying drug dealers who don't do nothing but just destroy their own communities, like you alluded to earlier. Right. So the first lesson we need to do to learn from here is learn each other.
Yeah.
Learn each other's names. Learn each other's culture. Understand each other's family background. Know the traumas that we've been through. And that's the, in my opinion, where we need to start first. And once we are also more patient, we need to be more patient with one another.
I would say the internet is really helping with that, though. It's a lot different than it was, let's say, 10, 15 years ago.
Oh, yeah. Now, you know, the dashiki right now is in style, right? Kondro is in style. You know, the jalong rice is
famous. Oh, yeah. The jalong rice. Everybody wants to check their DNA, which is an awesome thing. What God did with the year of the return was awesome.
So a lot of things, you will realize that all these bad stereotypes that we have about each other is that it came from lessons that I've been taught. The African American has been taught that they have been sold and betrayed by their own brothers and sisters in Africa. It's seen that they feel like it's unforgivable, they cannot forgive, right? So these are actual facts. But then Africans also, we come to America, we feel like, okay, we were supposed to be accepted and received by our African American brothers. But instead, we felt more welcome in among white people.
Yeah.
Right.
African leaders did sell them into slavery. They knew what they were doing.
But here's the thing.
What they didn't know was the inhumane type of conditions they were going to put them in, to their defense. But they did sell their brothers and sisters away.
So I would rebuke that because you got to look at the whole concept of how slavery started first.
Okay. Right?
Okay, you got to understand in days of slavery, some of the things they consider selling. I could have sold you, or you could have sold me into slavery without you having no ownership, or me having no ownership over you. I could just be a village idiot, right?
Right.
And see, these are facts. As long as they find one person from a village who is a native of the village, can shake hands with them and say to them, okay, I accept whatever deals you want to do any type of trading.
But they had not known that was wrong, though. You don't think?
But this is what you got to understand. Why, where in this world, if you go to Brooklyn right now and you find one Latino guy who said to you, okay, I can sell all these Puerto Ricans to you right now as an individual Latino, how does that make sense? He's one Puerto Rican Latino dude. How can you sell the entire Puerto Rican people just because you are one idiot? These are some of the things that they did. But let's look at it. Let's look at the facts. The facts that they didn't tell you is they didn't tell you how the Mau Mau of Kenya fought to death to protect themselves against, you know, colonial invasion or white people invasion. They don't tell you about how the Zulus fought in South Africa to death every day against these people. They didn't tell you how the Mandingos of Mali or how the Fulani tribe of the Fulani of the Fudajelong Islands. They didn't tell you about none of that. Yeah. So what they didn't fail to tell you is how resistant, how the Asante tribe in Ghana fought with all they had. Yeah, Asante, we have a story, right? What's he did? How strong he stood for our kingdom? They didn't tell all of them. The part one they want you to believe in is that one village idiot who accept their deals and decided to say that, okay, I accept your deal. I will sell all these other people. TK, EK, Mamadou, Lamine, have them all. Oh, by the way, you can put my one down there too. You can sell them, all of them. They can all go.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. So, I see your point. But you know, those are things like, you know, we have to come to terms with it and really start working together, quite honestly. And I know that I'm happy that this time around, the conversation that I'm having around the Black Lives Movement isn't, this is not our fight. You know, like I don't have to have that argument anymore. As of 5 years ago, I was still having that argument. This is our fight as long as you live here. But now it's different. I think a lot of people now are beginning to understand how America, how the white colonialism systemically put African Americans at a place that they are right now. And as Africans, there's no, you go to look for a job, there's no checkbox just for you, African. You still got to check that African box, right? So
you're black.
are black.
So it is our fight. It is indeed right. Our fight. So but what do you say to our people that now say, in response to Black Lives Matter, the people that say, that bring up black on black crime? What do you say to that?
So usually I don't address it. And if you look at the articles that I've written about the Black Lives Matter, I deliberately refuse to indulge in that, right? Because I feel like it's nothing but a distraction used by racist, Nazis, you know, talking points to try to distract us from talking about the main issues. But in moments like this, I have the time for that.
Okay.
Right? You have to break it down and look at it into perspective.
Yeah.
When you talk about that, first of all, there's something called black on black crime. Crime happens within proximity, right? When you go to Nigeria right now, you will not find Ethiopian killing Nigerians in Nigeria. It's not just going to happen. It's Nigerians killing Nigerians in Nigeria. When you go to Ethiopia, the same thing. Gambia is the same situation. So when you go to a black neighborhood, who you think is supposed to commit crimes in black neighborhood? It's black people. When you go to white neighborhoods, who are committing crimes in white neighborhoods? White people. Same thing applies to Latinos and every other race group, right? So crime happened within proximity. But now let's analyze the African-American communities. Where does this history of violence come from? Why are we so broken down and destructive or almost self-destructive in our own communities?
Mm-hmm.
It's historic. This didn't happen by accident.
Right.
So if you look at the history of America, let's take it back to the 60s, during the presidency of President Nixon.
Yeah.
That dude, in order to pretty much cater to white voters, he started his war on crime or war on drugs or whatever he called it.
Yeah.
He was specifically targeting black communities, arresting black men, putting them in jail, making them criminals. When they come out, they become unemployable. They don't have work to do. What do you expect them to do apart from sell drugs or commit crimes?
Right.
And his own aide, John Ehrlichman, came out years later, admitted that that was their strategy.
Yeah.
The war on drugs in 1968 was solely to cater to white Southern voters by President Nixon.
Yeah.
Now, let's look at the 1980s. When Reagan came into the greatest Republican president apart from maybe Lincoln, right?
Yeah.
This brother, with his wife, right, Nancy, what did they do? War on drugs.
Right.
War on drugs. We all remember Nancy Reagan's famous quote: "Just say no."
Just say no.
What they were telling you behind that was just say no, was that they were targeting black people. Crack cocaine, the crime associated with crack cocaine, became severely compared to.
All those big names that you hear in the black community that were doing drugs was around that time.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So when you put higher punishment or heftier punishment on crack cocaine compared to white cocaine, you are targeting black people and minorities to put them in jail. And because it only makes sense. Black people were broke and poor, and the people who use drugs or chose drugs can only buy crack cocaine.
Exactly.
When white people or white suburban and white children or white high school kids who are using all type of pills and white cocaine, they call it mental health diseases.
Opioids.
Right. And they go to psychiatric institutions.
Exactly.
Black people go to jail. When they come out, they become jailbirds. They cannot find jobs. What do you think they're going to do?
When you
call President Clinton,
the
so-called first black president, right? Yeah, we're going to talk about him too.
Okay.
When they came up with the crime bill, which, by the way, right now Joe Biden is trying to run away from as hard as he can. You know, but just for the record, I will vote for him over Trump, but that doesn't mean that we don't remember, right? Because in 1994, they were the one championing the tax strike law. Black people who are
Biden was part of it.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
He was. He voted for that bill.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So when they put black folks in jail between 1980 to 1997, between President Reagan administration to President Clinton administration, the number of prison population in the U.S., get ready for this, went up from 50,000 prisoners to 400,000 prisoners.
Wow.
Majority of them Blacks.
Yeah.
40% of our prison population is made up of Black people. And we only made up of 13% of the U.S. population.
Exactly.
How? How? Right? When you look at our redlining, what they do to black people, right? They devalue the price of the housing market in Black communities.
A Black person moved in to a white neighborhood, right?
And they make it impossible for you to move into a white neighborhood.
Exactly.
Now, because these are the consequences and repercussions of that. Our public school systems are funded predominantly by our housing tax.
Yeah.
Property tax. That's what funded public schools for the most part. So you see white neighborhoods with public schools literally looking like private schools, and you go to Black neighborhoods, our public school look like a prison system.
Yeah. And it could be between the white neighborhood where you see the good schools and the Black neighborhood is really just maybe a few blocks apart.
Just a few blocks apart. But the way the school public system are funded from property tax.
Exactly.
So if our properties in Black communities are so devalued, so depleted, how can we fund our school system? So now you have Leroy in going to the Black neighborhood public school system, very little chance, very little, not very good public teachers to begin with, very little amenities that he required to prepare himself to get into college, finally don't make it to college at all, drop out of high school or made it out of high school, and that's the highest level of education that he has.
Yeah.
What do you think Leroy will be able to do with his life?
Yeah.
Take him from that point.
And, and if he manages to make it to college, does better than his white counterparts, he doesn't get a job, the white counterpart gets a job.
Right. So he ended up what? Committing crimes. And we call it Black on Black crimes. We have to look at the root causes of these crimes. Nobody commit crimes because you love to commit crime. No, people are committing crimes for the most part out of desperation, out of need. And if you put crabs in a barrel, crabs do not belong in a barrel.
No, they belong down.
Right. So when you put them in a barrel, what they're gonna do? Hold each other down.
Yeah.
That's all what it is. So you don't blame the crabs for doing that. You take the crabs out of the barrel.
Yeah. Listen, you guys, I told you that this show was going to be so informative. I hope you're taking notes. And from the comments, like I see comments are coming in. Jenny is saying that's what we call modern slavery. They use, you know, Black people for labor, you know, Black people in jail. Fidelia is saying everything was intentional. Efua earlier was acknowledging something that you had said. I forgot what topic that was because we've talked about a lot so far. Mm-hmm. And Jenny is asking, do you know how much they made putting Black people in jail?
I don't know the numbers, the finances.
But they're private companies, though.
Right. But here's another stereotype, right? I thought this was the case because this is the public talking point that people will say. Oh, they put people in jail just because of they are private prisons. Here's a sucker for you. Only 6% of the U.S. prison system are owned by private entities. Only 6%. All these people are going to federal prisons. They are going to prisons built by government, putting their citizens in jail. So this narrative that privatization of a prison system and profiting from the prison system, no, it's not. It's our laws. The laws are broken and the laws were put in deliberately to put people in minority communities in jail. And the only way we can stop Black people from going to jail is not changing prison systems. It's changing the criminal justice system where they have to deliberately enact new laws that are going to change our old laws that are discriminatory and borderline racist that put people of color in jail.
Yeah. So, and these are answers to questions coming from African brothers and sisters that want to bring up Black on Black crime or African brothers and sisters that even bring up tribalism. And I will say that most of us, if you coming from Africa here, not understanding how the whole system works, some of us still bring that mentality of tribalism and try to apply it to what's going on here. How do we further get through to those brothers and sisters of ours that want to live here, that want to benefit from everything that African Americans have fought for. But then again, You don't want to understand their plight. You don't want to, you have the nerve to look down on anybody.
So here's the thing. We have to understand the causes and effects. I'm big on causes and effects, right? When I see you all beautiful, all nice today, and tomorrow I saw you cussing out and acting crazy, I'm not just going like, oh, she's crazy. I'm trying to see, where did she change? Yesterday, she was perfectly fine. Mm. She was beautiful. She was great. What happened, right? Mm-hmm. So when we see things, we have to first look at the causes. Why are people acting the way they are acting? Mm-hmm. You got to understand that the African has been abused so much that we thought the position that our default position we're in right now is how things are supposed to be. Tribe in itself is not a problem. In fact, it's a great Nigerian writer, Chimamanda, who said that before I was an African, before I was a Nigerian, what's our tribe again? Was it Igbo? So yes. It seems that my ancestors were Igbo first, before they were everything else, right? Yeah. So meaning, being a Igbo man, a Yoruba man, or a Fulani man, or a Mandingo man, is not a problem. What has become a problem is when the colonial masters came, and they tried to do the divide and conquer mentality, to tell the Yoruba man that you are better than the Igbo man. Tell the Igbo man that you are better than the Fulani man. They tell the Fulani man that you are better than the Hausa man, right? And now they are all fighting for power and superiority. So that's the first thing we have to make sure we change about ourselves. That, okay, you being representative of your ethnic group, you being representative of your culture and your tradition, doesn't make you tribalist or sectionist or anything whatsoever. You are just part of who you are. But it doesn't make you any better than the other person. But because of we are so taught with this negative stereotype that we are better than the other person, because of what we believe, whatever we come from, we brought that thing here. And some of us, we feel like, oh, we are better than these other Africans here.
Yeah. We have superiority complex amongst ourselves in our own different countries, let alone outside the country. So,
right. So you got to remember one thing. There's a certain stigmatization that goes with slavery in Africa, right? When you look at our caste system, you know, you have the nobles, the royals, the servants, the warriors. You know, you have different the goldsmith, the fishermen, the farmers. You have different levels or sections in our caste system. The slaves are always at the bottom. They always have the worst. So the mistake we assume is we thought, some of us believe that African Americans are slaves or descendants of slaves. What we didn't realize is that it wasn't slaves that they brought to America. They brought our traditional engineers, our traditional doctors, our traditional security men, and women.
The brightest, the smart ones.
Our brains, right? These are some of our the smartest. Why do you think the most advanced black men in the world are found in America? Why do you think that? Why do you think that they came from slavery and they are billionaires today in America?
Yeah.
Why do you think that they build their own institutions and they are governing themselves very well privately in their private lives? Why do you think that the Black Wall Street in Oklahoma was destroyed by racist white people? Because of these black people came from great men and women. They are brains, despite of what we are led to believe in. This way, the African, you know, great that we are captured and brought here as slaves. So make no mistake and think that don't confuse slavery with the caste system of what we call slaves in our culture.
Yeah, and you have some of our African brothers and sisters that think just because they're African, they're better than the African American. You know, like I always go back to the movie Hotel Rwanda.
Right.
And there's a part in that movie, you know, Don Cheadle was in it. Mm-hmm. There's a part in the movie when Don Cheadle was asking the American soldier, why can't you get us out of here? Mm-hmm. And you know what he said to me? He said, you're African. You're not even a nigger. So you are the bottom of the totem pole. I said, that's a wake-up call right there.
Right.
Like you're not even the N-word. You are. We consider the ones that you might be looking down on first, and before we consider you.
I had that experience in Europe, right?
Yeah.
I went out with some of my friends in Europe, and we went to a restaurant, And we were in France. And when we got to the restaurant, I couldn't speak French. They are all very fluent in French in France. So obviously they, but nonetheless, when they speak, people can tell they are not French because their accent or whatever.
Yeah.
But I had to try to put my orders in with a little broken French and trying to use as much English words as I can to communicate. I had to survive.
Yeah.
So quickly, people will learn that I sound American. To me, I don't. But to them, I sound American, right? And very quickly, I realized perception changing towards me against my friends from who live in France.
Yeah.
I give better services. When I do this, waitresses are coming running.
Oh, wow.
Right. The waitresses are coming running to me, right? When they talk to me, they're doing it with smiles. Their smiles are big as hell, right? So it was more, I had a better, more friendlier service because they assume I am African-American. And my friends.
And also they thought you were going to give them tips because, you know, giving tips is not is an American thing. It's not a European thing.
Right. But I didn't know that part. But for me, all I could tell was I sound, in their understanding, American. So I must be American. So I receive a better treatment because of my affiliation with America. And my friends who had French citizenship, who will be living in France forever, cannot receive the same dignity and respect from their French counterparts. So that tells you, as Africans, you are right. They don't even see us as the N-word. We are below.
Yeah. I had the experience in France. My experience was in Paris. I walked into a restaurant because I did say bonjour to the owner, to the restaurant owner, but he didn't. So, you know, because you know the French, they don't like it when you don't try to speak their language, right? So I did greet him in French. He didn't hear me, and when he came, he said, "You can't say hello. You Americans are so rude." I said, bonjour. He was like, "No, you didn't." I said, you know what? This is my cue. I need to go because I'm not going to get good service here. You know what I mean? So I had the opposite reaction from, you know, you did. Mine was like, I tried to speak French and it wasn't good enough.
I don't know. I don't know what it was, but like I said, I received better service. I was treated better.
I can tell you that.
And the only thing I can attribute that to is I don't speak French like they do. That's it.
Yeah, and that's I could very well be very true because I can totally see that. Let's read some of the comments. Fidelia is agreeing. She's saying tribalism is a real thing. And Jenny is saying, let me see. We should do something about it on how the budget is being allocated for each city as it affects our education system. And she was talking about when we were discussing the issue on the schools. Yeah. And saying why our education system is depending on the funds of the cities is so our children can get good education. And she furthermore said that I have to pay more taxes and higher price of housing so I can guarantee that my daughter will have a good education. But, Jenny lives in, Jenny, you live in Montgomery County, I believe. Montgomery County is the third richest county in the country. So, you will pay higher taxes to live
in Maryland.
It's in Maryland. That's where I moved from, so I know. Another reason why I haven't moved my brother from Montgomery County to New York is because I'm like, I don't want him to lose those benefits that he has. Mm-hmm. Fidela saying again, tribalism was planned by the white man, i.e. Rwanda genocide. Do you agree with that?
Absolutely. You got to think about the Rwanda genocide. How did it happen?
Yes.
When the white people were there, initially, power was with the what? The Hutu tribe. And when they're about to leave, they flip it and give it to the Tutsis.
Exactly. Right?
So.
Yeah. How many people were lost in the genocide?
Over 400,000.
Wow.
Over 400,000 people dying in April, the bloody April massacre in Rwanda. And that doesn't include Burundi and the parts of Congo that also have their tribal wars forever. So Africa is a mess. We need help.
A lot of it gives me goosebumps. We do need a lot of help. We do need a lot of help. Fidelia is asking if the French like Americans. I don't think they do.
No. I don't say they like Americans. I'm saying when they had a binary decision to make between the African and the American, or the African American, the African American came on top all day.
Yeah. Again, reiterating that we're Africans, we are at the bottom. You know,
right.
Like they mentioned in the movie. Afua is saying it's very expensive. Afua, I'm assuming you're meaning the school system.
Yeah.
Fidel is saying Montgomery County is no longer the third richest. Which one is it? I thought it still was. Which I know it's definitely not PG County. Maybe it's no longer in Maryland. Fidel, if you know, please let us know. If you know which county is the richest in the U.S. So again, I want to thank you guys for coming on, and please pick up Saikou Camara's book. He has two books. You can find them both on Amazon. I think I have it somewhere here. I'm going to post it. Let's see. Yes, the first one right here, Testimony of an African Immigrant, A Promise to My Father. And the second one is Africa Through a Mirror, We Have a Continent to Build. You can find these two books both on
Amazon.
On Amazon. Yeah. Definitely find them on Amazon. And you know, for our show today, do you have anything else that you want to add? Because I feel like we can talk here all day forever. It's amazing getting to pick your brain.
So what I will say, one thing is that when we started the conversation with Hustle Like an Immigrant, I would like us to take it back there, back the way we started the movement, also like an immigrant.
Yes.
If you want the T-shirt, you can get it from Saikou Speaks.com. Saikouspeaks.com.
Yeah.
You can find the T-shirts there.
One
thing that is so dope about the immigrant, especially the African immigrant, is our resilience, right? And like I told you earlier, I pretty much attributed it to five factors that makes immigrants' mindset completely different from natives anywhere they go. And even in America, if you look at it, over 26% Africans have the highest degree attainment, with all the insults, with all the criminalization of immigration, calling a shithole countries and all, we still have the highest degree attainment rate in the U.S., even compared to white America, right? Yeah. Over 26% Africans in the U.S. all have degrees.
Yeah.
And with our Nigerian brothers and sisters, they inflate those numbers and they kill them. You can hardly go to anywhere in America where you will not find Nigerian doctors and professionals, you know, in private, running their own private businesses and whatnot. So that is very, very good. So the question is, where does that come from? Like I said, I attribute it to five things. The first one is, I don't care where they come from. Stop any immigrant, anywhere you go, and ask them a story about their immigration story. Why did they move? How did they get to where they got to? Mm-hmm. Whether it's them or their parents who brought them to where they are, there is always this dope, inspiring story on how they make it to where they made it to where they are.
Yeah.
I remember speaking into a woman from Cameroon in the UK who was telling me how she got her children to the UK. Where she had to work for 3 nights running away from the, when there was a change of government in Cameroon from independence, you know, how her husband used to work for the Cameroonian government. He was assassinated, and security agents or his adlis called her to let her know that they just killed your husband, leave the house, they're about to come get you.
Wow.
And she had to work 3 days to get out of Cameroon and finally made her way to the UK.
Yeah.
Those are dope stories, right? Well, you talk about the Asian lady from Cambodia tell you their stories, how they make it to the U.S. Or listen to a Nigerian brother tell you how he was a shoemaker in Nigeria, how he made it to the U.S. These are all inspiring stories. So one of our biggest inspiration as immigrants that set us apart is our why is fundamentally strong for the most part. And because life is full of obstacles, you're going to get hit with obstacles. Hardship is going to happen. And trust me, Obi, you're going to have disappointments. So unless you have a strong why that can keep you going, you will not keep going. If I tell you right now, I want you to walk through the concrete wall, you will look at me crazy. If you have children and they are on the other side of the concrete wall and the building is on fire, you will think twice. You will knock it down.
Exactly.
Your why determines a lot of time the effort that you put into things that you're trying to achieve.
Yeah.
And the second aspect of hustle like an immigrant is your worth, right? Once you already decide why you are inspired, now what do you want to do, right? I met young people like my own sister. She has a PhD now, but that wasn't because of she always wanted to have a PhD. When she was younger, she wanted to be a medical doctor until she realized that she can stand blood, but she still wanted to be a doctor. How? When we were much younger, my mom got diabetes. So in order to get her diabetic pills and get tested or whatever, diabetic shot or get tested to take her blood level, it was expensive. We couldn't afford it. So every day it was a hit and miss, whether she's over or she's low in her sugar level. And my little sister at a very early age said, I'm going to become a doctor and one day I'm going to kill you. So since she was a kid, she always kept this thing in her mind, I'm going to be a doctor. Until she get to university and realized that becoming a doctor, you have to actually take blood. And in a biology lab, she had to literally carve a rodent. And she's like, no, I'm not doing this. But she still went on to have her PhD. That inspiration came from, why did she want to do it?
Right.
So she already had a plan. What do you want to do? Usually inspired by your why. So your what is always as important as your why that inspires you. And your what also determines what plan of action you're going to put in place to achieve your goals. Your what determines what type of food you want to eat. If you want to lose weight, you can eat pizza every day.
No way.
if you want to be a doctor, you cannot go out and drink every weekend with your girlfriend. Yeah. Right? Every Friday cannot be happy hour. You're gonna miss a lot of happy hours. Mm. Right? So if you want to go whatever you want to achieve in this world, your why, what determine your lifestyle.
Yeah.
And then the third part of it, you have to be disciplined.
Yeah.
Right? When you look at immigrants, we do 2-3 jobs, right? You are doing this right now. I guarantee you, you didn't have to tell me. I didn't read your resume. I guarantee you, you have another hustle that is completely different from you sitting here interviewing me, right? And you can talk to almost every immigrant, right? When we go to places, so a lot of times we don't just do one thing.
Yeah.
Like I envy my colleagues in school who just go to school and sleep in the dorm. I had to work 2 jobs and go to school. I still have to maintain my GPA, right? So that hustle is a complete different. Our level of discipline is at a different level. We have to be self-disciplined in order to achieve the goals that we want. So we are usually very, very disciplined in the chase of our ambitions and our goals. And then the fourth aspect of it, perseverance. Yeah. We all went through some something, right? Every immigrant you met, they can tell you a terrible story that they've been through in their lives or their family life, right?
Yeah.
And they had to overcome that. They had to be resilient. They have to continue persevering. So perseverance becomes the fourth factor that set out people, that part of the hustle like an immigrant mindset. You have to persevere no matter how difficult, no matter how tough it is.
Yeah.
And the last part is the risk. Nothing is riskier than leaving your bath country, your home country, mama land. Right? Home cooking and everything.
Yeah.
And you went to a complete foreign land. A lot of times you don't even speak their language.
Mm.
And you say, I'm here, baby, let's do this.
Yeah.
That's a huge risk.
Yeah.
That's because immigrants have no fear at any given point to give up who they are to become what they want to become. And if you want to become successful at any given point in life, if you have to give up the person that you are today, the person you were yesterday, in order to become the person you are tomorrow. This is the five pillars, 500 principles, also like an immigrant. What is your why? Have a strong word, be disciplined, be ready to persevere through hardship, and make willing to risk it all at any given point and do it all over again if you have to.
Yeah. Wow. That's amazing. Listen, this is a word to last you, not just for the week. I'm talking about the whole year. No matter what COVID-19 is doing, it's done some disruptive stuff, but if you follow these five principles, trust me, I mean, we're all having to, you know, rebalance and, you know, reconfigure everything that we're doing now. So having the five disciplines or the five things that you just mentioned is actually key, is a major key to really being able to come back out on top. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. So, and I'm going to read a few more comments. Miss JD, I believe she's watching us from YouTube. She's saying, the books are a must read. Grab your copies. Thank me later. aforementioned something about self-discipline is key. And Jenny did some research, I see. Jenny said Loudoun County, Virginia, and Howell County, Maryland is the richest county in the U.S. I've been living in Montgomery County in Maryland for 15 years. Housing here is $650,000 in our area. In Gaithersburg, and our city taxes are high. And Fidelia is saying, Jenny, I know Howard County has surplus milk, and I think it's not even the 20th. Woo! I was off. I was really off. It's not even number 20. But yeah, thank you so much for the feedback and the research, Jenny and Fidelia. I appreciate you guys. And I appreciate everyone for tuning in. Thank you for taking out the time, Mr. Saikou, to be on the show. Like I said earlier, I've been trying to get you on this show for like forever. When I say that, you tell me I'm saying alternative facts, but it is.
Hey, it's been since 2018. We've been trying to make this happen since 2018, right?
Yeah.
Like Drake said, God's time.
Yeah.
So we have to wait for it. And when it comes. And I appreciate, I'm honored that I'm here. Like I said, I love what you do, especially I love how you do when you do what you do.
I appreciate you. Thank you. Thank you so much. And thank you, everybody. The show is going to live on the News with OB YouTube page and on the Facebook page. If you want to do a rewatch, if you want to reshare, you can always come back and do that. And I try to do this every Wednesday. So if you know anybody in the community that's into politics, that's making a huge impact in their community, please have them refer them to me so we can work out something for them to be on the show. Any last words from you, Mr. Camara? Where can we find you? Instagram, social media, websites? Talk to us.
Hey, you can find me on IG on Saikou Speaks. Saikou Speaks on IG, on Twitter. Saikou Speaks on Twitter as well. You can find me on Facebook as Saikou Camara. Saikou Camara, or you can also visit my website at saikouspeaks.com. Holla at your boy, and don't forget to get your shirt or grab your books on Amazon.
Thank you. Thank you so much, everybody. We'll definitely be in touch with Mr. Saikou, you know, helping to move his business forward as well. Thank you all for tuning in, and have a good night, everybody. Bye. All right, don't leave yet. Hold on.